Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Parallax Abstraction, and welcome to another episode of Retro Flashback, showcasing gaming's roots for a new generation. So, for this episode, we are diving back into Capcom Arcade Cabinet. Had my fun little break there, did those couple episodes of Double Dragon, and we're still going to be taking fairly frequent breaks from this collection. We're gonna, as I said before, we're gonna sort of spread this out over time a little bit more, just because people are getting bored seeing this stuff from the same pack all over again. So we're gonna dive back in for this episode though, and we're going to be taking a look at Commando, which is, I believe, Capcom's first licensed game. Now, all this really is a regular game that they had in development anyway that they put the Commando name on because it timed out well with the Arnold Schwarzenegger movie. So they really have nothing to do with each other, but, you know, it became very well known for that reason at the time. This is before most licensed games were known to be, well, cash-in garbage. So, but yeah, this is a really popular title with a lot of people. It's sort of very well regarded. I don't know, this never really hit a chord with me. Funny enough, I actually principally played this game on the Commodore 64 more than in arcades. And I actually, it was so long ago, I don't remember the Commodore 64 version very well, but it played similar ideas at the very least. And I don't know, it didn't resonate with me as much, but we'll see, you know. Everyone's opinion varies, right? So hey, let's give it a shot. Alright, so here we are. So, the general idea is you shoot a lot of dudes. You know, a game called Commando, what would you know, right? And it's weird because this game, as you can see, it kind of plays almost like a shmup in some ways. Except you're shooting humans and your character is not a ship, it's a person and it's shooting other people. But you sort of see the idea here, right? You're aiming and shooting. And you also have your grenade button, which is sort of an area clear attack. Again, not unshmup-like in many ways. Now, as you can see, though, this game is very, very frantic because the enemies don't really move in set patterns. Now, this was conducive to a lot of the Capcom titles that I've actually, from this era, that I've actually showcased on previous episodes, in that they sort of differed from a lot of what was out there at the time because they were, most shooter style games like this had very specific enemy patterns. As you can see, this game is also ridiculously hard. They had a lot of specific enemy patterns, so they would come in to the screen in a certain way that you could memorize and you would deal with them as they came in, and that's kind of how it worked out, right? That was sort of the general concept, whereas in games like this, the enemies had their own rudimentary AI behaviors and would tend to, they would spawn in the same places, but they also came in very, they would come at you in different ways, and they would sort of focus on your current position and attempt to swarm towards you. And that was kind of the difference here. And that made the games both very interesting and also beyond blindingly frustrating, as you can see right here. This is kind of why I don't like this game very much, because even as arcade games go, it's brutal. Like, it shoves you right into super hardcore, very, very difficult action. It doesn't really ease you into it. It doesn't give you a level where it keeps the challenge kind of a bit lighter just so that you can sort of get used to things and feel like you're on a roll before it ramps the challenge up. It just sort of kicks you right in and is like, screw you, go to it. And that's, you know, a lot of people like that. That's considered very respectable for a lot of people. And if you're into that, I get it. But I don't know. I just don't find that terribly fun. And, I mean, right now you can see, to try to give myself a little bit of an advantage so I can make this a little bit more interesting for recording, I'm actually playing this using the auto-fire button, which is by default bound to the right trigger on the 360 controller. Just to try to make it a little easier on myself. And it's, even in this case, it's still very difficult. I mean, the key thing in this game, right, is what you need to do is be always pushing forward. What gets you screwed is if you stop for too long and you try to focus on what's on the screen, as you can see here, rather than progressing as far as you can. Now, as you also saw, there was something there, a guy that looked like a hostage. If you can free him, you get a pretty nice bonus. It's actually much harder to do than it looks like. It's pretty tricky, actually. And I can rarely pull it off because I'm just not that good at this game. I don't recall the Commodore 64 game that I played of this primarily being this difficult, which was not unusual. A lot of home computer and home console versions of games like this tended to be a little bit simpler to get into. They weren't quite as punishing because, well, on a home system, though the games were still relatively short and had to try to keep you engaged for a number of hours, they weren't as concerned with just getting as many quarters from you as possible. So they tended to ramp things down a little bit. So I don't know. In order to show you a decent amount of content in this game, this may be the first game where in this collection where I actually have to drop down to casual mode. Because, yeah, I don't know. Like, I really like the concept of this game. I really like the way it plays. And this is one of the few games in this collection that is actually very well suited to using the analog stick on the 360 controller as opposed to the D-pad, or if you have the means, a controller that has a decent D-pad. But, you know, because this game definitely it has 8-way movement, so playing this with the D-pad would actually be very difficult and very frustrating, or more so at least. But you can see here, right, that this game just requires and sort of demands really, really frantic play. Hey, there we go, I got that guy. I got him free anyway. And this is a style that certainly a not insignificant number of people will get into. But I don't know, like, I could appreciate games of this nature getting this hard, you know, a few levels in, but on the first level, like, when you're not even remotely near the end, to be just getting kicked in the face by the game, I don't really see the entertainment value in this. Or at the very least, if this was more like some of their other shmups and whatnot, where you had a life bar and it wasn't a one-hit kill. Like, if this had, you know, if it took 2-3 hits to take you down in this, okay. There we go, now I freed him. I don't know why it didn't count the first time. Like, that I could get, because, you know, you're taking your time, you know, and you could be like, all right, I got in an encounter, I got hit, I got, you know, it hurt me, but I'm going to work my way out of this, going to try to recover a little bit, and it'll be all good, right? But you're barely halfway through the level, and you come to a situation where you're on a bridge, and there's a bike spamming endless grenades at you. And yeah, you can run by it, like I just did there, but that's a risk unto itself. And it's just, I don't know. It's too bad, because the base idea of this is great. Like, I like the idea of a game that plays like a shmup, but you're actually moving a dude and fighting other dudes rather than, you know, planes or what have you. It's cool. It's just, oof. It's really, really rough. So, I hate to say it, call me a weak sauce if you must, but I think I'm going to drop this sucker down to casual mode just so I can show you at least an entire level. Because this just ain't working so well. Now, I can't remember here. I don't remember if, because I actually haven't ever used casual mode in this beyond showcasing it. I can't remember. Okay, so I didn't have to enable any particular options. It does have, it's got at least a few things on, because I have 12 lives, or I have not 12 lives, but I have a bunch of extra lives and I have 12 grenades. And it definitely appears that the hitboxes have been increased and the dudes are just not shooting at me as much. Very much the case. So, alright. So, but this is kind of a neat way to showcase casual mode a little bit more, I guess. I mean, we've talked about it in the first episode of this series, and it's still pretty brutal. We've talked about it in the first episode of this series a little bit, where I showcased sort of the wrapper and user interface for this collection, but I never really demonstrated it in full glory. And this is kind of what it is. It is a cheat mode, but it's not a cheat mode in that, like, you're not enabling God mode. You're not making yourself wholly invulnerable. I mean, there are ways to make it almost that easy if you want, but it's just taking the difficulty down a notch. And this is kind of cool because it does give you the means to practice with the game and have a little bit more, you know, have a little bit more fun and just sort of get used to it. So you see here, this is the end of the level. There's no actual boss here per se. This is just a wave of enemies. Broke the first area. Now rush to the second area. I'm gonna smoke this cigarette because that makes me better at battle. So you see there was not that, but now look at this. Now we got vehicles. Oh, good God. Because, yeah, things weren't awful enough before. Now we got cars to worry about. But you're seeing here that casual mode is definitely making things not a super cakewalk, but it's definitely making them a lot easier to get into. And this is cool because you get to see what the levels are like. You get to learn enemy behaviors a little bit easier without getting just constantly beat about the head and face. And it will make it easier when you, the next time you want to go into normal mode. This just sort of eases you into it. See, if the game started out sort of like with this level of difficulty, now you see there as well, another casual mode thing, guys can't kill you by touching you. That's a pretty big plus, I have to admit. If the game started out a little bit more like this level of difficulty, where it's not easy, but just not utterly, brutally unfair, then I'd probably get into it a lot more. Because I don't mind it being challenging, I don't mind it ramping up the challenge, it's just when it starts off turned up to 11, just not for me. So that was a short one. Off to the next area. Is he having a drink? So I'm gonna smoke and I'm gonna drink. Sure. So, yeah, I don't know. I like the idea of this, but I think it's just a little mean. It feels a little mean-spirited, maybe, in its design philosophy. It feels like a game that was a little bit too focused on monetizing, a little bit too focused on vacuuming quarters from players, and was more interested in that than having a good curve and easing people in and making things as much about fun as getting money. And that's a shame, because that's the best arcade games are the ones that can strike a balance between those two concepts. And either because it just wanted more money for whatever reason, or because the designer's vision was to make something brutally hard. I'm not sure which it was. But it doesn't really matter at the end of the day, because the game's still not all that fun for me. More smoking. Now rush to the last area. Yeah, it's too bad, because this is cool. But you know what? This may just be me, because Commando is, a lot of arcade historians, what have you, a lot of arcade people hold this game in very high regard. And at the time, it was pretty innovative and pretty different in a lot of ways. This game did a lot of stuff, especially with this enemy behavior and that was kind of unprecedented and pretty impressive technologically. I mean, technologically, it is very, very cool, and it is very neat. But as you can see here, it's just about throwing you into this torture chamber of a level gauntlet, and it's just, I don't know. It seems that It feel this is a game that maybe this is maybe it's not true. Oh God, fire! Wow, that's some horrible fire. Torch your place, and I'm out. Peace. That's my first duty. And so that's the thing. It's like your first duty's finished. And now we drop you in the next one. Back to work. You had your little smoke break on the chopper there, and get back to it. And it kind of progresses like this. And I'm sure there are skilled players of this. There are probably speedruns of this game out there where people have sort of learned how to min-max and fully utilize how to exploit the AI and things like that. But this is a game that just feels like it's one of those games that, whether intentional in the design or not, feels like it's more reliant on luck than skill. And that's not the best way to design a game. It doesn't matter if it's an arcade game or another type of game. It's just not the way to maximize fun, I guess. So, like I said, that's my opinion of this game. You know, you may disagree. A lot of people probably do disagree. And I mean, if you do buy Capcom Arcade Cabinet with the all-in-one pack, which is what I seriously recommend doing, then you'll get this either way, and you can sort of judge for yourself. But yeah, that is Commando, published and developed by Capcom in 1985 for arcades. There are a number of other versions of this available as well for, various home computers and consoles. As I said, I seem to remember the Commodore 64 version playing a little different than this and without as much punishment. But it's been a long time, so I may be remembering that wrong. But yeah, it's highly regarded, but doesn't hold up for me. My name's been Parallax Abstraction. Thank you all very much for watching, and I'll see you next time.